their part of the value, weight cannot be levied. Whether the same principle can apply under GST?
Obviously they can apply.
In my opinion, yes. But nobody has dared to do that. Even under service tax also.
They don't want to.
But nobody has dared to do that. Even service tax also the same principle can apply. Okay? But this is one. Third, valuation mechanism or its absence, whether it can, something. Simple case, land. I'll come to that. If the land value, one-third deduction is given, what if the land value happens to be more than one-third?
Go for divisible method.
So, that is not prevalent in Maharashtra. But I am just laying down the broad proposition. Then validity of valuation on the basis of value of the similar flats. Can there be a similar flats concept applied, applicable? We will see that. Inclusion of cost of land in the taxable value. These were all the issues which have already arisen in the previous regime. Either under service tax or under VAT. Inclusion of value of free issue material. The Bayana builders, larger bench, upheld by Supreme Court with a detailed judgment, whether the ratio will apply. Restricted scope of entry relating to horse contract. Taxability of development rights, the raring issue right now. Taxability of transferable development rights, which is normally prevalent under Mumbai, TDR.
TDR.
Right?
Again, TDR, the reserves have TDRs.
Right. Then, taxability of joint development agreement between the landowner and the developer. Taxability in case of redevelopment of society. Taxability of the corpus fund, accommodation allowance, etc., which we discussed. Taxability of free of cost flat allotted by the developer to the members of the society in the case of redevelopment of society or in Mumbai MADA or SRA project, where the original encroachers or the holders of the units, they are being given free of cost. Taxability in case of redevelopment under SRA scheme. Then, if I sell any product, any flat after CC, complete consideration receiving after CC, whatever I sell, consideration is also received after CC, obviously, then only. So, whether I am required to reverse the proportionate settlement credit, I have taken the full credit, everybody is reversing the issue. Whether under GST, the new notification, unbooked flat, which are sold as on the date of the CC, unbooked flat, units, which are sold after that, it is required to pay the GST proportionate to development rights attributable to on the basis of the value of the similar flats. Come to that. Conflict between the entries relating to construction service and works contract service. Practically, by now you must have realized at a glance that almost all these issues have survived under GST. So, there is no end to the pain of this sector. Almost all these issues, and these are all live issues. And the same issues can arise in the GST also. Now, GST and the constitutional framework, this again, can I expedite? I don't know, I mean,
how it is. What is its constitutional amendment?
Any idea? I want to just move it fast.
Down.
We can shift it to the
consent. If you can, I tell you the slide number. You can write down the slide number. The notification number 11/2017 central tax, right? 3/2019 has been issued in under provisions of section 9.1, which I mentioned specifically as a charging provision, 11.1, which is an exemption from tax, 15.2, which is a valuation provision, 16.1, which is an input tax credit provision, and section 168, the power of the board. So it's a complete recourse to more than one provision to issue one single notification, a very unusual thing we have ever come across in the entire indirect tax structure, resorting to more than different provisions to issue one condition. The purpose is very clear. The board philosophy guided this new tax structure was twofold. One was that real estate sector is not passing on the benefit of ITC to the end customers. That was one. Government was very sure, very firm in their mind, so they were annoyed. It's not right. There were few elements, but they have taken a very common view for everybody. Number one. Two, that these notifications, the announcement come when the elections were in office. They were to come.
Yes.
So customers were to be sent a very right message, common men, that we are here to take care of you. So we are going to prescribe a very, very nominal rate of tax, making it affordable for everybody. So it turned out to be, unfortunately, more a political decision rather than an economic or a policy decision. That was that. Council announced nobody would object to, states would also not object to. Everybody wanted to send the right message to the right people. So that was that. And the notification came to be issued. The first and foremost thing, it says 1% for affordable, 5% for non-affordable, other than affordable. Right? This is the rate. And you do not, you can't take ITC. And this is mandatory. If you see the FAQ, two FAQ which have been issued, this is also mandatory. So you have no option. The first question which arises, is this mandatory or not? Can it be said to be mandatory? You have to compulsory, and do you have any other option to go for? Can you pay the tax, to put it very straightforward, can you pay the tax at the full rate and take the full credit or not?
That is always available.
But how?
No.
Yes and
no? No. New projects.
New projects. I'm talking about new projects.
New projects.
New projects. Right? But even for new projects, the answer is yes. You can. Now, one. On what basis this is said, you have no option? Section 9.1 is a charging section. Right? It prescribes under which the tariff rate is to be prescribed. This is a charging provision. Once the charging provision tariff rate is prescribed, then obviously you cannot deviate from that tariff rate. This is one. Coupled with that, ITC benefit is denied as a part of the condition. That condition can be prescribed under notification 11, under section 11. Section 11.1 empowers the central government on the recommendation of the council to exempt any supply, either wholly or partly, with or without condition. So that is a standard power under, we had in service tax section 25, etc. So this is section 19.6. So these are standard power, nothing wrong in that. The question here is this. For denying the option to deviate from this rule, 1% and 5%, the section 9.1 is actually presented before me. Okay, this is a charging provision, you have to apply this rate only. For condition to deny the credit, 11.1 is being prescribed. And other conditions, there are a host of conditions. Is it permissible in law? If you carefully read 9.1, it does not allow the central government, even on the recommendation of the council. Means the council cannot recommend any conditions while prescribing the tariff rate. They have no power to prescribe the condition. They can only prescribe the rate, which is generally known as a tariff rate. Section 11 cannot prescribe simpliciter conditions without specifying the partial or full exemption. You get my point? Please read this. These are not part of the PPT, but you can read this. Section 11.1 cannot prescribe conditions in isolation without specifying the rate, concessional rate or full exemption. Section 9, charging provision, cannot specify the condition. It can only specify the tariff rate. you cannot do the marriage of two. So you cannot say, yes, I am prescribing the condition under the notification section 11, prescribing the tariff rate under section 9, and reading these two together. So for condition you read section 11, for tariff rate you read section 9, and reading these two together, there is no option available to you. This is not permissible. But section 15.2 is merely valuation mechanism. It has nothing to do with it. It has been by resorted to, but anyway, it empowers the government to notify certain value and class of persons. That's why. Section 16.1 says every registered person shall be entitled to take the input tax credit on the inward supply of the goods or services or both. It says so. Correct? Subject to such safeguard or conditions as may be prescribed. This is the condition. Section 16.1 does not even empower the central government to specify any conditions by notification. No, not amending it, sir. They have no power to issue notification under Section 16.1. The word prescribed has been actually prescribed has been defined under Section 2 interpretation definition section as prescribed by the rules. It will always be like that. You see your income tax also. Prescribed means prescribed by rules. It will never be by notifications. So Section 16.1 does not even empower the central government to issue notification. They can only provide the conditions by rules, not notification. So it does not carry the case further. Last but not the least, that 2/2019 notification which we studied for composition 50 lakhs, it is also issued under 9.1, it is also issued under 11.1, it is also issued under 16.1. And there, the condition which are prescribed in the column 3 of the table, it starts with a taxpayable, a registered person who opts to pay tax under this notification. There you are making it optional, though it is the same three provisions. How can you say that this is mandatory? This comparison nobody has done so far. And the final point is, please read explanation at the end of section 11. There is an explanation, solitary explanation, which says, if any exemption, whether wholly or partly, is provided unconditionally, that is absolute, it cannot be foregone by the taxpayer.
It is conditional.
Right? So if there is an absolute exemption notification, whether partial or full, without any condition, you cannot forego. 1% and 5% is subject to conditions which are running into 10 pages. How can you say you cannot forego? That explanation has been completely given a go by. Completely. It has its roots in section 5A of excise. Service tax, we had no such provision. In excise, section 5A also provided for the same. Absolute exemption wholly or partly cannot be foregone. It has its roots in the small scale exemption notification, which Dr. Vicky Singh introduced at the time of moderate introduction in 1986. 7.5 lakh exemption with 25 lakh turnover limit.
Yes.
So the OEM people said, small manufacturer vendor, please don't avail the exemption. Our moderate credit chain is breaking. So you pay the duty. Don't avail the 7.5 lakh exemption. Department did not like their paying duty. They said, no, you must avail this exemption. The matter went to larger bench. That was this. So that was a larger bench. And then we relied upon IT judgment on depreciation, whether depreciation benefit is compulsory or not. They later on they made it mandatory by amending the law. But at that time it was not there. And the larger bench decision came that you cannot impose the exemption on somebody. Exemption is always imposed, optional. Then they introduced section 5A in excise saying that absolute exemption, absolute. If it is a conditional, you. Here also it is conditional. Sum total of all this is that 1% and 5% is optional. Secondly, the law is so badly worded, if I commit the breach of the condition, what will be the rate applicable?
Maximum rate.
I mean, there is no provision. There are no provision provided for. If a concessional rate is given to me, if I commit the breach, something should follow. There is completely, the law is silent. We are at a dead end on that. Another reason, Para 3, which was introduced by 3 by 2019, last entry 12, residual entry 12, these are all Roman 1, 2, 3, 4, new entries. Last entry 12, if you read, it covers construction service. Under which it is 18%. In our view, in my view also, that today also a developer, if he is inclined to do so, has an option to pay tax at 18%, claim full deduction of the value of the land, not one third, full deduction of the actual value of the land, and take full credit of the credit on the goods and services. This is conclusion, I am not going further on to this. This is the conclusion. One. Two, another issue arising out of this is the landowner vis-a-vis the developer. Landowner granting the development rights against the constructed area is given. Either it is an area sharing or it is a revenue sharing. Correct? Whether grant of development rights can be said to be a taxable supply of service. It cannot be goods, so can it be a supply of service? Development rights is a benefit arising out of land. Land is defined under Constitution. Land is also defined under Transfer of Property Act. Land is defined under other enactments also. So land includes benefit arising or attached out of the land. Development rights do not exist in isolation or on standalone basis. Development rights owes its existence to my ownership of the land, what we call as the FSI or what. It do not exist. Therefore, it is covered by land. Land is an immobile property, and therefore development rights cannot be subjected to the levy.
GST
at all. It cannot be. Same principle applies to TDR in our Maharashtra. When the transfer of development rights are created, when suppose there is a SRA scheme or MADA scheme, correct? And where we are building, for which the developer, either somebody is holding the land, government takes over that land for any purpose, for which he is given a TDR. Yes. So that TDR is given by way of a certificate. It is freely tradable in the market like a corporate entity, public company sales certificate. So this TDR is it's actually not in existence per se. It is under certain circumstances that the TDR generated in favor of by the local authority in favor of the developer. So TDR also, there cannot be a tax. Once the development rights cannot be said to be, Sardodaya, Bombay High Court Housing, Sheda Housing, there are host of judgment. We support this proposition. Once the development rights cannot be said to be liable to tax, everything else becomes totally immaterial. Whether it is area sharing or revenue sharing or the full cash payment or the constructed area to be given by the land developer to the landowner by way of a consideration, nothing becomes liable. It is an immobile property. One can also say it is a barter in the immobile property because development rights is an immobile property. Constructed area which is given is also immobile property. It is a barter in the immobile property. From that perspective also, it is outside the purview of the levy. Then they say, the fourth proviso, landowner, if he sells a constructed area before CC, then he will be liable, but he will be, as if there is a great mercy shown, he will be entitled for the ITC of the tax which has been charged to him by the developer. Can the landowner be made liable when he is not providing any construction service? Where is the supply? He is only supplying the under construction unit to the new buyer. Isn't it a resale of the property, akin to resale of the property? Can the landowner be brought to the levy at all as a supplier of anything? He cannot be put at the same pedestal as the developer who is engaged or can be said to have been engaged to undertake the construction service.
Landowner, no GST.
There cannot be any GST. There cannot be. Then they say, 6 by 2019 and 5 by then the reverse charge and all, that development rights are exempted in case of residential project, but subject to unbooked flat on the date of issue of the completion certificate, you have to pay the tax proportionately to the development rights attributable to the area which is sold after completion certificate. And what is the valuation mechanism? The new para inserted by way of a in the notification is value of the similar flats. So So what is being valued? What is flowing from the landowner to the developer? Development value. It is a supply, assuming. In the hands of the developer, it is a consideration, supply, receipt of supply. Constructed area to be given is a consideration against that. That constructed area to be valued at the similar place, can that be applied? In a typical development, joint development agreement, a developer would say, you give me constructed area equivalent to 40% of the development rights. Against that, you take 60%, which I am transferring in your favor, for instance. So then 60% developer will construct the sellable flat, and 40% equivalent to 40% he will give the constructed area. Now, the 60% sellable area, the flats which is being sold, that is being valued inclusive of land value, because there is a transfer of the undivided share in the land in favor of the buyer, plus construction cost. As far as the 40% constructed area, equivalent to 40% which is given to the landowner, he is already holding the development rights in the land. He has never transferred that. So even though you are providing the one-third deduction of the value of the land, even though it is being provided, the cost of the proportionate cost of the land is getting shifted into the constructed area valuation if you apply the similar slate concept in the case of landowner. Because at least you are paying the tax on the 67% of the value of the land. Here there is no transfer of land taking place in favor of the landowner. It cannot, because the projection does not arise. Is it legal? Is it constitutional?
No.
No, obviously no. Tax on lands and buildings is today also is a subject matter of the state. Under state lease entry 49 probably. Yes, 49. Schedule 7, Article 246. It is still a subject matter of state. Whether indirectly also the tax can be levied on the value of the land. Same principle would apply when, like in a city like Bombay, where the value cost of the land probably comes through 60 to 70% of the total cost. You are giving me deduction only of one-third. So indirectly, on the anything excess of one-third, there is a tax on the value of the land. Is it permissible? Encroaching upon the state powers? This issue is pending before the 9 judges constitutional bench in the mineral development case. So we are waiting for that judgment. So there is another challenge to that. And where is the question of similar flats? What is similar? Nothing is similar in this country, particularly in this world today. A next door neighbor flat in Mumbai, every flat is sold on an independent basis. Every flat commands its own value. There is nothing like similar flats. Absolutely nothing. Then comes the free of cost.
Apartment features are changing now.
Yes. Free of cost flats which are given under SRA development, slum rehabilitation authority or MADA. Or redevelopment, or society. A society building is being demolished and it is being converted into a new building. When this is given, is it really free of cost? The question is that, what does society do when he engages the developer for the demolition of the existing building and the redevelopment of the new building, society, new construction? It only gives the builder a permission to construct few more floors on his head. Original 4 floors, or 5 floors, he says, okay, construct 2 more floors, subject to FSI and everything. That is a builder responsibility, that's a sellable area. The cost of, the free of cost which are to be given, the agreed area which are to be given to the members of the society, its cost is always included by the builder into the cost of the sellable area, on which he is paying GST. He was paying service tax. So this is not a free of cost. Can it be subjected to a separate levy? And then also on the basis of the value of the independent flat sold by the builder? TPL builders, Bangalore Tribunal, very recently said, Vasanta Green Project, Bangalore Tribunal, Vasanta Green Project, where they have identical issue, they said, the free of cost units given to the member, original members cannot be subjected to levy of service tax. Though it is before Supreme Court, but yes.
Proportionate land also will be
nothing. Included, sir. Yes, this is another issue. Yeah. So therefore nothing is free of cost. Same principle will apply under GST, right? The other part is, even in case of landowner and constructed area to be given today, when does the taxable event take place? If assuming supply of development rights can be said to be a taxable supply, when does the taxable event take place? on the date of the JDA agreement. That is undertaken today on 26th June 2019. My first flat may be sold to the independent buyer maybe after 3 years or 4 years, depending upon the size of the project and other factors. Can you apply after 4 years to whom somebody I can sell the flat, that value to value my development rights and constructed area? Can it be said to be nearest to the time of the grant of development rights? Another challenge. 4. Development rights is a consideration in kind flowing from the landowner to the builder developer. It's a consideration in kind. Suppose it is 100% consideration in kind, there is no case involved. If you carefully see, this is another lapse on their part. Nobody again realized this. Valuation rules of CGST rules.
Even realize nobody is contesting it.
Yeah. That's why now everything is coming out. The value, I'm talking about the general professional opinion also right now. The views which are taken across the country, they also not realize all this. Forget about the policy makers. The question is, valuation rules, if you carefully see, there is not a single provision which provides for the valuation when the 100% consideration is in kind. Rule 27 only provides for when the part of the consideration is in money. Two illustrations given under Rule 27 also further buttresses this point. If you see the title says something else. They wanted to do it when 100% consideration is in kind. But the rule somehow or other has been very poorly drafted. This was not the case under Section 67, Finance Act, with the valuation rules there under. They had taken care of that also when 100% consideration is in kind. Today there is no consideration, there is no provision for valuing when the entire consideration is in kind. Valuation mechanism fails, levy fails. Again, Govind Saran, Ganga Saran, and Nathuram Agarwal. BCC, again, the other challenge to this entire provision. And the finally, about if the free of force units are given to the original beneficiaries or members of the society, whether SRS scheme or MADA, under Maharashtra, means MADA hours, Maharashtra state. Then, am I required, if I don't pay tax, am I required to reverse the ITC? Now the ITC will not be available. But till 31st March, suppose, whatever, or service tax also. In my opinion, even ITC or sandwich credit is also not required to reverse, even though I am not paying service tax or GST on the free of cost allotment to the existing members or beneficiaries. Because it is not free of cost at all. And therefore, it is not required. And the last point is, all the units which are sold after CC, completion certificate, where I am not paying service tax earlier and I am GST, assuming it is liable, I am not paying the GST at all, to proportionately, am I supposed to reverse the credit? No. So, am I supposed to go back to my original quantum of credit which I have taken, work out the proportionate credit and reverse it today? My answer is straightforward, no. There is no provision, there was no provision. I am not saying the reversal is not called for. But it would become exempted supply, which itself is a debatable. Can it be treated as exempted supply? Whether Schedule 3, this comes under Schedule 3, sale of building. Right? It comes under Schedule 3. Therefore, non-taxable. Under construction, so you are paying tax. So, whether Schedule 3 supplies can be treated as an exempted supply? That is another important question. Again, in my view, Schedule 3 supply cannot be treated as an exempted supply. Though exempted supply definition includes non-taxable supply. Then also, this is not a non-taxable supply. These are outside the purview of the law. Where is the question of my treating it as a taxable, non-taxable, etc.? So therefore, non-taxable supply, if it does not include, then this was sale of building. It is not required. It, assuming it becomes exempted supply, it is in the year of the sale of that unit, post-CC, it will become exempted supply. In that year, if I have any taxable supply, I will apply the proportionate formula. So, if I have undertaken a project as a builder in 2019, 2022 I received the CC. After 2022, whatever unit, suppose I sell some units in 2023, if the same provisions continue, it can be said that 2023, whatever units I am selling post-CC, that is an exempted supply in that particular year. If in that year I have in the same company another taxable supply, I will be required to give the proportionate treatment in that year. I do not have to go back to 2019, 2020, 2021, work out proportionate credit and reverse it. Again, this has been held in TPL Builders, Bangalore, after they have relied upon division bench in Gujarat, Alembic Chemical. This was the opportunity after 15 years we have been fighting on this. So every single person has accepted, because we have accepted all the builders, and builder would never take a chance. But nobody ever, either they were taking proportionate credit as per the construction, or they were reversing it. In spite of that, there is no provision whatsoever. So, and the last is the icing on the cake, and then I will conclude this, is whether levy of, just like levy of IGST on imports, which according to us unconstitutional, whether levy of GST on construction service per se, maybe 1% or 5%, whether it is permissible in law. Again, our review is this, builders are not liable to pay GST at all, neither 1%, nor 5%, nor 18%, nor 12%, nor 8%. They are not liable to pay. Particularly after the amendment to Section 7, retrospective, it has become much more clear that they cannot levy, GST cannot be levied on construction service at all. Para 5B is the only provision under Schedule 2, which says any part of the consideration is received prior to completion certificate. I explained, if Schedule 2 is not a deeming provision, did I explain? It is now clear with the retrospective amendment. It has to be a supply. What is the transaction here? Construction service, supply of under-constructed unit. Go back to 7.1. What does 7.1 say? Supply means supply of goods or services or both. Under construction unit is neither a goods nor a service nor both. So if it goes out of the purview of subsection 1, my Schedule 2 does not come into picture. Schedule 2 cannot be a charging provision. Unfortunately, they have made it like a charging provision. Schedule 2 cannot be a charging provision. It can only be a categorization, classification. It is not a charging provision. It can only be interpreted as a charging provision. So therefore, the very levy of GST on builder, even in case of under construction unit, is highly debatable. Highly. But, so friends, these are certain unreal issues or unreal work concerning the real estate sector. There are going to be, so that's why I started with, in the beginning I said, this law is not going to get settled down so easily. There will be lot of bumps and roadblocks and barriers and fine-tuning, and all these things are going to happen. We have to be prepared for this. Important thing is, we are all professionals. As a tax professionals, what we are supposed to, how do we approach the particular field? This can apply not only in GST. GST is much more a complicated piece of legislation overall, but any field, you might be practicing in Companies Act, another horrible piece, Companies Act 1913. What a beautiful piece, company law, original Companies Act 1956. Compare this with 2013, rubbish. So you might be practicing in that, you might be income tax. As a professional, whatever field we approach, you know, we have to keep our all faculties totally open. Totally. We have to learn. Just now, sir was asking me, whether I'm an advocate, CA, or I'm not a CA. Just again, some personal, I'm just feeling like sitting in a family. That this was never my field. Indirect tax was never my field. I never wanted to become an advocate. At 2 o'clock in the night, my statement has been recorded by excise officer. There's a 5,000 penalty also which was imposed on me in 1986 as an executive secretary, which was set aside by a tribunal after 7 years. When I was already practicing in indirect tax thereafter. My field was company law. I've done my company secretary. We have to clear one group of finals. And as the destiny had it, I got in. But I was handling excise. I have prepared get passes myself. I have prepared RT12 returns myself, keeping two carbons, nothing digital. Life was very, really simple at that time. Because we knew what were the complications. Not like this, unexpected. So, done, I was doing cell tax and I was doing company law. This was my field. But as destiny had it, I owe my entry to department.
But advocates live on disputes, we live on growth and prosperity.
Yes, maybe. But I'm very clear in my mind, sir. I'm very clear in my mind. A society which is mushrooming with advocates and doctors, it's a sick society. If you have many doctors, means you are physically sick. If you have many lawyers, it means you are mentally sick. So, I mean, I'm not too much proud of anything. But the question is destiny heading. And from that, the life has been interesting. So, thanks, thanks. I cannot thank you enough for such a
Sir, one small doubt, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, is there any legal validity for 9 and 9C in the absence of 1, 2, 3?
No, I know that. That 9 and 9C, you can challenge. If you see the section 35.5, it says about 2 crore, you have to go to your account audited.
Okay.
Correct? It only says you have to go to your account audited. But audited means what? By whom? What are the format? Are you referring to whatever tax audit is undertaken or company law, whatever income tax audit? They are referring to that. But this is again a loose thing. Then you compare it with 44.4, right? It only speaks about reconciliation statement.
Yes.
But wait for some time, something good can happen. I am continuously trying. I have written in my article also, please scrape the audit for 17-18 at least. You may not like me. I might be hitting on your but I have been, after this, I have written clearly. Please scrape at least for, if not for 2 years, scrape it for 17-18. Or at least make it compulsory, preferably 25 crore or at least 10 crore. You will be doing the biggest favor to the MSME sector. And not a single chartered accountant which I have come across is 100% confident about his role and responsibility when he takes up OD. We are only accepting the assignments, finalizing the remuneration, seeing that the next door my chartered accountant friend does not take away that assignment. We are only worried about it without even knowing okay, what is our role and responsibility? Totally. It's a very, very sad affair.
Practically also it is very different.
Let us see. Later. Something may come out of this. But these are all challenges. And audit, already the earlier service tax audit, Gujarat High Court has said, you cannot enter the premises for service tax audit. Delhi High Court has said, very recently, last week Jharkhand High Court has said, they cannot undertake the service tax audit. After 1st July 2017.
I sent you a PDF file
to
your WhatsApp, sir.
Okay, I'll just look at it. One of my phone is off right now. So they cannot. But then we should have that courage to say on behalf of the client, if they want to undertake the service tax audit now, whether we will be able to tell them, get lost. You have no right to come. That's a challenge we have to face. Let us see. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Sir, that is a splendid and eloquent speech. Really, we are blessed to have you here. Thank you, G.V. Sachinan Garu, for bringing such a great personality. When he has given me card, Shailesh has given me card, has seen that SPS legal, underlining it, experience, dedication, integrity. That's what we have seen. Because there are three women chartered accountants also here. And they are not even one person has moved from their suites. That shows his caliber and really, really excellent speech. Each and every article or a section, how it is to be understood, that preamble, the content of the subject and the notes, that what he is preparing and the total authenticity of the subject and also the eloquency, the remembrance of the case laws and all these things. Really, really, sir, we are very much honored to be here, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Yes, he is the fastest in the meeting. He just conducted up to 11:15. Sir, if it is possible for you, on behalf of our management committee and along with the permission of the chairman, I'm just requesting you. August 9th and 10th, we are having our national convention seminar. If it is possible for you, our time is suggestible. We request you to present a paper in one of the good subjects that will be in touch with you, sir.
GST only.
Yeah, whatever the case may be.
No, no, I mean,
because it will be a 500 charged accountant.
So many people. I've attended one, but it will be my pleasure. But I will make it very qualifying right now also, just to put the people at a good rest and sleep. That at that time I will not exceed my time or 4 hours.
If time permits, you please give the date. Our Vijaywada people will be benefited with that.
9th and 10th, I'll just coordinate. Okay. It will be in Vijaywada. Okay, convention is being held in Vijaywada.
Yeah, in Vijaywada, sir.
So complete southern region.
Yeah.
No, state level conference.
अरे मिस्टर मनोज